unchecked from years of neglect. Crack smoked up welfare checks, food stamps in flames. So I got a slang ticket. While they bang, I slang. I am 13. Trips from New Jersey to New York on what's supposed to be a school day. The grams are priced just right. And if I sell enough, I could come back and flip this again tonight. I can't get these clips bagged up quick enough. The fiends are coming back to back after every hit. The money is coming and I can't go to sleep. I too am up chasing the money like they are chasing the hits from a crack pipe. We are both fiending now. Their drugs of choice is crack and mine is money. It's funny how these drugs got us all going out of our minds for it. They're dying to smoke and I'm dying to deal. More money is all I can think about. Forget about the fact that I have a daughter or that the police can haul her mother to a jail cell. As long as I got the bail, this is the hood. Her dad ain't doing shit for feeding me or eating me. I gotta eat, she gotta eat. This is the hood. I was born here, gonna die here. All I know is here, right where I am, and all I will ever be is here. They call me Red, cause I'm light skinned, with light brown hair and light brown eyes. But I'm just as black as any dark skinned girl. My insides are black, mixed with red, from all of the blood that's been shed. Maybe they should call me purple, the color purple. Not from royalty, but because of the poverty that has enslaved both me and my parents, aunts and uncles. We ain't free, even though it's the 1990s. America has waged a war on drugs, but I guess they forgot about me. Because my dad was shooting up before I was even born, and my mom was taking the first hits while I was taking my first steps. I imagine me, a toddler who needed to be swaddled. But there was a choice that needed to be made. And I guess the cravings of a fiend come before any child they need to feed. But I ate, cause I was hungry. I ate what any dude fed me. I ate off his plate. It only cost me a date. I ate until I became strong enough to feed myself. Instead of depending on him to feed and clothe me, only to snatch what he bought off my back, I began to do what he did. I became who he was, the money-making crack slinging. But America has waged a war on drugs, and I don't know on whose side to be. Because on one hand, I'm going to fight for my parents, who can no longer fight for themselves. But on the other hand, I want to fight for my life. Cause there's no help for me in sight. If you say the police on these streets are here to protect and serve me, well, I guess you're right. Cause they tip us off every time they're supposed to come and raid these streets. But America has waged a war on poverty and on drugs. But I feel like I'm the only one being shot at. Am I a prisoner of this war, casualty, or enemy of the state? I was hungry, so I ate. No serpent begilded me, a little black girl on these project streets. A ghetto celebrity is what they calling me. We got gold, clothes, beepers, and furs. Hustling is all we know. Education is a thing of the past that our ancestors used to get ahead. Instead, we are being left back or dropping out in order to pursue our dreams to become street pharmaceutical kings, or in my case, queens. I'm running these streets, or is these streets running me? Cause I'm 18 years old now, with a 2-year-old. No hopes, no dreams, no goals. Hustling is all I can think about, so that I can pay my bills and to stay out of jail, now that America is saying that crack pills. I am so blessed to not have died a physical death. While I was out there selling my soul and losing my mind both at the same time. But like Maya Angelou said, yet still I rise up from a past rooted in pain. I am Kimberly Thurston Brown, and this is my show.
Hi, it's been Tay with Black Girl Monologues, and I am standing here with, sir, would you share your name with us, please? Dr. Barry Hopkins, a wonderful counselor. Correct.
It's a radio program. It's weekly on WSOU-FM, Cedar University.
Yes, and Dr. Hopkins, you actually interviewed a few members of the cast of Black Girl Monologues.
6, 7, 8.
The entire cast, everyone. So now, what made you come out tonight?
Well, I was excited because the scene is an actual production. It's good to talk to the women who are in the production, but seeing them on stage is a great thrill for me.
So now, what are you expecting to leave here with tonight?
I expect to leave here with some excitement. And I also hope that I can talk to somebody somewhere so that they too will come and see the production. Most of the things are hard stuff and other places.
Yes, actually, we do have another show April 16th, so hopefully you'll come on out and see our next show. And we've also added a teen summit for April 16th, so the youth are actually sharing their monologue. Yes, you do. You'll have a chance to interview them. Now, I know you're not a girl, because this is Black Girl Monologue, but if you had to leave us with one sentence, your own little short monologue, what would you say?
Be kind to men.
Be kind to men. Okay. Well, thank you very much for speaking with us, Dr. Hopkins. I really appreciate you and enjoy the show. Thank you. Bye-bye.
We will keep our bodies pure. We will keep our bodies pure. We will keep our
Night Girl Monologues tonight?
Of course, I had to come and support you. Of course, absolutely.
Thank you.
You
have an organization. Tell us about your organization and what it is that you do.
The organization is called Love Should Be Heard. It's actually a domestic violence organization to help survivors and bring awareness to those that are now in that situation.
And so we have women that are monologuing and they're telling their truths. Now, can you tell us a little bit about your story?
Absolutely. I'm a two-time domestic violence survivor. The last being about 6 years ago. And that's what motivated me to start the organization so that I can give back and I can share my truth with others in hopes that they will see the mistakes that I made and they won't make the same mistakes and hopefully be able to get out of that situation.
So now we are looking for other ladies to share their monologues and maybe come April, you'll share your story with us?
Absolutely.
She's not shy. You guys, thank you so much for coming out to Black Girl Monologues. Love you to live.
Thank you, Stacey Lamar.
And you are here for Black Girl Monologues. Why did you decide to come out, and who do you know in this production?
Yolanda Hughes is my first cousin, and she just a supporter.
You're just, well, family is a huge supporter. We know we can't do a whole lot without family. So now, looking around and seeing what your cousin has pulled off, what do you think about what she put together?
I'm not surprised because she always knows it right, and I'm just so proud of her.
So if you want to leave her with one wish tonight, what would you say? You heard that. Do the darn thing, Yolanda. All righty. Thank you so much, Miss Stacy, from Monologues. Please tell us your name. Hi, Sheila. And your name is?
Tanya Hill.
Now, you know, I heard that you are relatives of Yolanda. Is that true?
Yes, my first cousin. I'm the friend.
Okay, you're the friend. The friend of the first cousin. You know, it's family. It's all good.
Right.
Now, what do you guys think about the event tonight? Looking around and seeing what she's done, what do you think?
I think it's wonderful. Her speeches, I'm so proud of my little cousin. I think she's a genius, and I'm so excited to have you be here.
This is beautiful. They do the artwork, everything. It's lovely.
Now, what do you think about Black Girls Mom?
I know it's going to be a great night. I got my tissues. I know I'm going to laugh. I'm going to cry. I'm just ready for it.
You're just ready for it? Okay, what about you? What do you think about just the term Black Girl Monologues?
It's great. We need more of this.
Because we need to foster communication and dialogue. So now, since I'm mentioning Black Girl Monologues, you ladies have, you know, maybe a one sentence monologue. You want to make a stand?
I'm not ready for that.
Women, we always have stories. You guys are always ready.
Babies, I really am.
Now, you know, I often say that women empower women when they share their stories. Every woman has a story. So if you could share something with us, one line of wisdom, you know, if you were to give us one monologue in a sentence, in a line, what would you say?
I would say, whatever it is you're going through, don't die today. You can always die tomorrow. But live today. Don't die today because God ain't finished. And if you hang in there, there's a sunrise coming in the morning. And I guarantee you, if not tomorrow, the day after will be better.
All right, you guys, you heard it from Mama. I ain't that shit, Mama. Thank you so much. In every sense of the word, please give a round of applause for Jennifer Queen Moore. Give it up, you guys. Give it up.
And yes, I have my doubts that I'll make you there and back again. Unchange me now. No risk, the greatness was it, was it me?
It was a hot, hot Tuesday. Connor was around 3:30 in the afternoon. I was beautiful. Ball-headed mixed baby, I was ready to begin delivering to my mother. They put me in her arms and they kind of smiled and they named me Jennifer, the meaning of white wave, but I came rushing, I came ready. I came ready. Gave straight A's and half smiles. That was my parents' bright shining star, so I thought. I kind of thought that if I did everything right and I made these good grades, everything would stop, but yet, let me finish. There's something that I want to say to you. I want to get this off my chest. Just give me a few minutes. Respect me enough. Let me say what I have to say to you. I know I didn't do everything right. And maybe I should have said no a little bit more often, but he pressed a little bit harder. He promised me that it would hurt, and I said, Daddy, okay. From age 6 till I was 24, I stopped. I tried to save you. I tried to tell him no. If I passed that English test one more time in class, Daddy would let me go instead of pushing a little bit harder. And I tried to explain to family members, but they turned their heads, told me to be quiet, take it to God and leave it alone. How dare you? God knew that this would happen to me. Between floorboards and missing nights and broken promises, I was Daddy's girl. So much that when I turned 19, I wrote him on my arm. I mean, it was a way of life. Don't you tell me what you would have done. You don't know. Shh. You don't know about survival mode. Virginity, please. If they won't apologize, I will. My father made me feel guilty for the things that he left on my thighs. How dare you? Between pregnancies and rapes and you don't understand. But I still listen, and I never talk back, but my lip was severed plenty of times. I looked down at the floor because that's where my self-esteem was, right along with my virginity. I wish I had said no so that I could have saved you. Virginity, I'm sorry. You look so unrecognizable. I wish that I could share you with other people. Between the women and the men that I've laid with, I wish that I could have given you one more chance. But he snatched you from me at tender age of 10 right here in his dining room on Norton Street. Right in front of a table where there was Thanksgiving and Christmas, open presents and burned bruises. I lay there, crying the heaviest, most saltiest tears. You know he wanted to be my prom date? He wouldn't let me go with Quentin Ferris. Quentin came to him like a man and said, Mr. Elliott, please! Please, may I take your daughter to the prom? And he said, not if she couldn't be my date. You have no understanding. 32 now, and I've tried to put this behind me. I wish I could pick up the phone and call my mother just so that I can let her know that the cramps between this abortion was painful. If only I could have picked up the phone and have her tell me that there was a mixed brew of something. But I can't. My father's her biggest supporter and manipulator. It's not her fault. She was 15. He was 31. This happened long before I was born on that nice summer day on a Tuesday in September. I'm losing my voice because that's all that I have left. I can say this to you, virginity. I will protect you at any cost. So let me take what I have left of you and share you with someone that is worthy. Oh, I didn't tell you. There's a glass window that separates me and him. It's 18 years that he has to think about this. Yeah. I just wish I had a chance to say to him, this is not what I wanted. Wanted my family together. At least I can start with my virginity and I can say, Mama, let's start somewhere. Can't save me. I saved myself and I ran away. If I didn't, just think what the world would have missed. Hopefully he understands when someone says lay down, you lay down. When someone says get up, you get up. When someone says go to bed, you go to bed. Now you gotta listen to someone else's rules. You tell me.
Mommy, I didn't know you were dying.
I would have listened more. You would have never had to worry about my grades. I would have never talked back. Most importantly, I would have never got pregnant. They say it takes a year to get over the death of a loved one. I totally disagree. It's been 23 years, and I'm still not over it. I know she wouldn't want me to be this sad. I know she wouldn't want me to still be in this much pain. Mom, since you died, I've made some of the worst mistakes imaginable. I know you must be ashamed of me. From the constant drinking, the weed smoking, the pointless sexual encounters. Most importantly, I didn't protect mom like you taught me to. I didn't protect my little brother. I feel like it's my fault that he's locked up. Mommy, why am I in so much pain? I know you wouldn't want me to be like this. I did everything imaginable to stop this pain, and it just won't go away. It just won't go away. I miss you so much. Wish you were here just one more time to talk to. I wish you were here. I just need one more moment. I'd do anything to have you here with me today.
Will you remember me? I will always be you. I'm here with you, John. I'm within you. I'm here to comfort you. I guide you every step of the way. I'm your angel. I'm so very proud of you, Jahari. You make me proud.
It's been said that time heals all wounds. Over time, the pain just lessens. You see, the mind protecting insanity covers them with scar tissue, and the pain just lessens. But the pain never, ever goes away. I take each new day as a new beginning and a new lesson. Today, I realize that my mother lives through me. Today, I'm a stronger woman. I realize that I'm beautiful and I'm resilient, just like my mother. My name is Jahari Gardner, and this is my friend.
This is the Table Black Girl Monologues, and we have two very, very, very special guests here tonight. Would you please tell us who you are and what brought you out to Black Girl Monologues this evening?
My name is Cicely, and I'm here to support my sister, Yolanda Hughes.
And your name is?
Adrian.
Adrian and Stephanie, what do you think about Black Girl Monologues? I'm sure you've heard about this production along the way, and to now be here tonight, what do you think?
I just want to see my crowd and see the dynamics of the people that we saw go up from year to year and see how they bring the crowd.
Now tell me, how proud of the woman are you?
Very proud.
Now did you expect something like this from her?
Not to this magnitude.
So she surprised you?
Yes.
And it's an excellent surprise, right?
Yes, it's an excellent surprise, but she always wrote, so we always knew she could speak and write. But to see it to this magnitude is astonishing.
Mind blowing. Now, if we could send her away with one well wish, just wish her luck, say something to her tonight, what would you say?
I wish her all the best in the world. I'm here to support her no matter what endeavor she takes and whatever path she goes by.
And what would you say? Yes, we do. And on the count of three, ladies, we're just going to throw her a little kiss into the camera. On the count of three, one, two, three.
Ah, that's for you, Yolanda. Thank you.
Linda Street herself. Miss Linda Street is East Orange. She is very well known in East Orange. Tell us a little bit about what you do, Linda.
arts consulting company. So we work with visual artists, performing artists, and right now we're working with the city of East Orange to cultivate art and culture within the city. I love East Orange, I'm an East Orange girl, so whatever we can do here to, you know, sort of infuse this kind of activity. What's happening here tonight with Black Girl Monologues is what we want to see more of this in East Orange. So I do a little bit of everything with everybody.
Yes, and this is art.
And then what do you think about, you know, Black Girl Monologues being here at Cicely and Tyson? Well, I mean, I think that is probably the spirit of what Ms. Tyson had in mind with this center. I mean, it's an amazing space, and it's so underutilized. So many people don't even know that it's here. It's like a well-kept secret, but we don't want it to be a secret, and we want it enlivened. And I think that just the idea that we have Black women here telling stories and sharing their truths under Ms. Tyson's name is an amazing thing. So I'm so excited. You know, from day one, I've been excited about it. So this is good, and we need more.
And one last thing, you know, you just did an interview with Yolanda and myself. And so what do you, you know, after the interview, what do you think? What do you want to see for East Orange? If you could have one wish for the city of East Orange as it relates to art and entertainment, what would that be?
Well, you know, I grew up here, so I can remember that we were, I never felt like we needed to leave the city for anything that we did. We had our entertainment, we had culture in the sense of places and businesses that we went to buy things from people that we knew that made those things. And so I think there is just a huge potential to bring that back. And, you know, when you think about economic development and this whole notion of creative economic development, that's really what, you know, my arena is looking at. How do you take the things that you know how to do and make money from them? So I want to see more businesses here. I want to see, you know, we want to make this kind of place that people want to come to, like it used to be. So I want to bring that back.
Now, Linda, you've been part of the Black Girl Monologues family. If you could leave one wish for the ladies that are sharing their truths, what would you say to them?
You know, I think that it's not an easy thing to tell your story. And I always say, I heard somebody say this once, it kind of stuck with me. We don't look like our stories. So we see people, and they look a certain way, and they look tight together. And we don't know what they went through that morning, or the prior day, or the prior year, for years. And so it takes a lot, but it's important, because people need to know sometimes that they're not the only one going through something, or that has gone through something. So I think it's important, and I applaud them. I applaud anyone who's open enough to share the truth.
Now, Linda, if people want to find out a little bit more about you and where they can reach you, where can they reach you?
I'm so easy to find. I'm everywhere. Pink Dragon.
Follow the pink.
Pink Dragon MGT on Facebook, Twitter, Tumblr, Instagram.
Linda, thank you for being a dope show. Yes. All right, I'll see you inside. Thank you, my dear. All right, so we are back with Black Girl Monologues. I have a very special guest here tonight. Please tell us your name. Destiny Jones, I hear that you are connected to one of the cast members.
Yes,
I love your mom. Kim is such a source of strength. Now, tell us something we don't know about your mom.
My mom is actually really funny. She loves to tell jokes.
So now your mom has a story to share with us. Do you know a little bit about your mom's story?
Yes, I know a lot of people
Now, what do you think about your mom being part of this cast tonight?
I think it's terrific that she's a part of this cast. I feel like nobody can tell our story without her in the way that she can. And I feel like her story is motivational to girls all over.
So I know you're not a woman of a certain age like mine to tell, but I do want you to just make a word of wisdom for the younger generation.
I would just say always be yourself, stay true to who you are, and just always be yourself.
And wish your mom good luck on the
camera, okay? Mom, I'm so proud of you. I hope that tonight is amazing for you. Just keep doing what God has called you to do.
Let's go,
Mama.
Let's go. Come on, count 3, 1, 2, 3. Come on!
Thank you, Mr. Harvey Barber. The next Black Girl Monologue coming to the stage, we have a sister duo. Introducing Miss Mary and Rebecca Sturdivant. Please give them a round of applause.
Alone,
8 years going on 9, which is more than what any of us expected. But unlike you, I'm just this. A regular person that, according to others, aren't good enough to hang. Why did you leave him? Weren't you happy? These are some of the questions I asked myself as if she was there. I used to try my absolute hardest to fit in with you and your clique. But no matter how hard I tried, I was still never good enough for you. It just wasn't the same no more, and for some time, I couldn't look at her the same. I didn't care if she wasn't happy. Because deep down inside, I despised her. You ruined my life. I was always told not to stoop down to your level, but people just don't understand how hard it was for me to forget about it. I knew no one was as good as my father. If y'all clean y'all room, I'll buy y'all skate. I love y'all like y'all my kid. This is gonna be hard to believe, but I started messing up in school and skipping class. All of this just for your satisfaction. And you don't even understand how hard it was for me to even get you to talk to me. It feels just like yesterday. Well, I seen the boxes in the corner, her naked left hand, and my two favorite people sitting together. But that's what happens when you want to be cool, right? You probably made some stupid decisions just to be like everyone else, haven't you?
Man, shut up. This man shuts me out enough and I'm only 18. The messed up thing is that she didn't even tell us about it. He just popping out of nowhere.
Yeah. We all get it, but now that I look back and think about it, you were never really worth it in the first place.
No preparation tool? Just a big old surprise. Next thing you know, boxes are being packed and moved into his house.
Now that I think about it, I'm not sure why I envied you so much in the first place. I mean, you're a teenager just like me, and we both know that looking good doesn't always equal to feeling good about yourself. So for now, I'm just gonna have to decide to be okay with who I am and just prepare myself for the woman I'm becoming in the future.
Okay. It's whatever. You ain't even gotta be like me. I'm putting myself in enough pain than it already seems like. See, since then, I knew it wasn't gonna be the same. The little visits are never enough. For better or for worse, right? Nah, life ain't up what you thought it would be. See, I know I'm just a teenager, and our parents think we are so far gone in our teenage world that we don't get affected by the changes they make in their relationships. But we do. I do. And it's hard. It's hard being a child, of course. My name is Mary Sturdivant.
My name is Rebecca Sturdivant.
And this is my truth.
We're back with Black Girl Monologues, and I am here with Councilman Ted Green from the city of East Orange. Would you please say hello to our audience?
Hello, everyone. I am excited to be here tonight. Not only am I excited, the city of East Orange is excited because when Flores is asking me to be in touch, asking me for me, I really feel good about that. But we are honored to have everybody here tonight. So Cicely, Tyson School of Performing Arts always have been a pet peeve in mind because our goal was to bring these type of performances here in the city of East Orange. And not only that, have other big performances coming. So to me, this is a great start. It's a great thing for the city of East Orange, and all of us are happy.
So for the people that cannot be here at Cicely Tyson Performing Arts High School, what would you tell them about this school?
You know, one thing I can tell them that we all know we have a young lady or not a young man, but an individual who all our young people and elderly people have seen across the board. Cicely Tyson, who represents not only school well, but represents us as an African American woman. So our young people should know that there's history behind Cicely Tyson School of Performing Arts. So I'm honored to not only be here tonight, but also have her name tagged as someone that I have seen over the years that she has been filming not only for herself, but for African American women and men. Yes.
Fantastic. Now, as a man, what do you think about Black Girl Monologues? She's the title on it, women sharing their truth.
Well, I think that, you know, even as a lesbian Christian, there are many times that we come in contact with women who are really going through different things in life, but you'll never know this. A lot of times, I look at my mom and get some help, but where was she to tell our story? So, you know, tonight to me is not only being here and being on the camera, but more so to support women of this nature and hear some of the things that they have been through or they've gone through. And maybe something that I can help somebody with during my legislative time on council to make sure that I do my part of supporting things like this as of tonight.
Well, we are coming back April 16th, so maybe we can have a few more of our council people come back and hear these women share their truth. What do you think about that?
I think it's a good idea, and I tell you, once I go see the show tonight, I'm definitely going to shout out on council Monday the 14th and tell them I did the show. And not only that, a show that gave me an idea of what people were having. It should be made me feel better, folks, as a man.
Amen. So it encouraged you to love the women
in
your life just a little bit more.
Oh, yeah. Without a doubt, I love all of them, but it's going to make me love them even stronger.
Thank you, Councilman, for speaking with us tonight, and please enjoy the show. Nice to meet you. Nice to meet you, Black Girl Monologues. We are here with Mr. Robert Hilliard. How are you doing this evening, sir?
Great.
Now, you are Yolanda's coach, and you've been behind the scenes throughout this entire production. So give us a little tidbit of information, what you thought about it along the way.
I think great concept. Yolanda has told me a lot about what she's been doing, what course, and then about the monologue. So I think it's a great concept. I think it's something that a lot of people should hear about.
So I know you're not a black girl monologuing. You are a man. Now, do you have a monologue? Do you have a sentence? Do you have a word of empowerment that you want to share at all?
But you know, just be your name, whatever that thing is. You know, just whatever your dream is, get some people that support you. And,
now, after tonight, what do you want to do after tonight? All the coaching, I guess, has come to an end. What happens after December 12th?
Coaching network. There's always something else to work on, and she has a lot of great ideas and a lot of great concepts.
And now, let's send her one well wish. If you could just look into the camera and just speak a well wish for Yolanda, what would you say to her?
Do your thing.
Do your thing, girl. That's it. Thank you, Mr. Robin Lee. I look forward to seeing you inside. Enjoy the show.
No actors, Black Girls Monologue. Give them another big round of applause, everybody. Give it to you. Mr. Woody and Steve. We're crushing the time in here right now, so I'm going to get right into it. Can you nay nay? Can you nay nay? Can you nay nay? Let's hear it for nay nay, ladies and gentlemen. Here we go.
Tried to take from me.
robbed me of my education. You did everything in your power to keep me out the classroom. But I guess you didn't count on my determination. And of course, you tried to rob me of my very existence. You made two attempts on my life. But I'm here. You see, every time you thought I was bowing down, too weak to move, I was praying. You see, I had a praying grandmother, and I have a praying mother. So I knew that my God had much more in store for me than just the pain and agony that you could bring.
Right when they're now, that's when they're You go, girl.
Thank you.
This young lady coming to the stage is hilarious. And word on the street is that she is looking for a boo. Next Black Girl Monologue coming to the stage, please welcome Miss Tia Williams.
You know, you may not understand, it might sound strange to you, but
I have allowed procrastination to eat me alive. So I looked in the mirror and I said, Bria, Bria, I'm so sorry. So sorry that you aren't the person you were supposed to be by now. See, I've been dealing with this for 15 years. I even died and they brought me back to life. But if I would have took care of the things I was supposed to take care of, I would have been further in life. See, everybody thinks it's fun and games, but life is a hard pill to swallow. Sometimes we choke, and sometimes that pill get caught in your throat. But I keep going. See, I just think about what my grandmother used to say. She used to be like, troubles in my way. I had to cry sometimes. Troubles in my way. I had to cry.
Great. City of North New Jersey. We're printing Miss Allison James, if you could please stand on behalf of Black Girls Monologues. We honor you today. She's here tonight. She is from our great city of East Orange, and many of you must have seen her on the internet. Her prom dress took us by surprise, and we are here to honor her tonight. Miss Kima McIntyre, you can please stand. We honor her.
Alrighty, you guys, we are almost there. We do have a gentleman that's coming out. I like to say he is the Barry White of our Black Girl Monologues. Also, you know, my middle name is Queen. In case y'all didn't know that, just listen to his monologue and you'll know what I mean by that. Bring it to the stage, Mr. Black Thought himself.
I'm going to give you my version of a queen. Queen, you are so much more than a fine ass and thick hips, goddess, oxygen, the main ingredients for life. To the soul of a king, I promise you, you are lovely. Heaven, the most essential creation on earth. You have the power, so don't allow us, your fathers, us, your brothers, us, your boyfriends, husbands, damage or destroy you while in turn destroying us. A delicate jewel that's been buried for years. Feelings drown in your tears, you begin to feel as if you've lost your shine. Queen, my queen, may I remind you that you are benign. Your divine purpose is to love, be loved, nurture, be nurtured. Not reproduce a replica of the ones who desert you. Because you were hurt, broken hearts on the menu. Many feet are left at your table by those who left you weak, mind, unstable. Jaded, hurt, hungry, unfulfilled. No longer do you have the desire to build with one who's right. So instead you settle. You settle for the pilots who take flight in the middle of the night, dude. Do you know I love you still? The cycle continues. Years filled with pain, plenty of heart, years filled with pain, plenty of fires, dozens of flames. Your heart still broken, well, what remains? Thoughts left unspoken, nothing gained. Will this cycle ever end? An attempt to love a better you, receiving a bitter you, I walk away. I walk away losing my best friend. I'm not the one to blame attempting to love a heart that's full of shame, I mean. Damn. Maybe you're in pain. I'm in pain as I walk away. It ain't my fault. Brothers, we're born kings, providers, protectors, to shield them, hide them from the lanes. But instead, what do? We creep. Creep inside their window pane and dive deep, so deep inside her rain. And boy, how she rains. Now, as my brother's keeper, his trash, my treasure, I vow to keep her, to teach her how significant she still is to us. Significant to me. Teach her how life on life terms don't always have to burn. Today, right here today, you heard she spoke of lost love, trust, and pain. She also speaks of finding self-love and how it was her game, how it umbrellaed her through. She is the audience for the audience's you. What's been missing for some time now, long overdue, is the acknowledgement of you, our queens. Although others have hurt you, grasp onto my love as I rebirth you. True kings gotta protect, they'll never deserve or neglect you. I ask that you forgive me. Forgive me not only for the freedom of you alone, but for the freedom of us. Let's be free from this hurt. Made from my rib and I from dirt, you complete me. I love you, we need you. Let's make this thing work. I acknowledge you. I acknowledge you for all you do. All you've done since day one has been my A1 beyond prepared. And those who hurt you before me, before us, I ask that you forgive them. As they transform from once boys to now men, I ask again that you forgive them while in turn forgiving us. Be a part of this healing process. Trust your heart if your mind permits. Kings, real kings, we do still exist. This is a must. To avoid a reproduction of us, hurt people, and search for love, yet misled by lust. Queen, my queen, the mothers of this earth, you brought life to the world long before hurt. So together, let's create and raise queens. queens like you or kings like me who know and truly understand firsthand the queen's reality. And I am Black Thoughts, and this is my truth about you.
Black Thoughts. Black Girls Monologue, ladies and gentlemen. Give them a big round of applause. Now, okay, I gotta mention that, you know, I hosted a lot of shows. I've been down since the Frankie Crockett days. But remember Tyler Perry?
Yeah, absolutely.
He started doing stuff like this at the Beacon Theater and other shows like that. I got this feeling that this is something that's gonna, like,
blow up.
It's gonna take up. I just got that feeling, right? These are not actors, they're actresses.
Exactly. These are real women sharing real stories.
So, and any one of us can get up here and be a part of the show. How can we become a part of the show?
Well, you can simply contact us on Facebook, Black Girl Monologue. So please, we encourage you to share your truths. And we also want to remind you that we have another show coming April 16th. So you guys look out for us. We're doing big things, all right?
Right. This is so powerful.
So thank you very much for coming out tonight. We just want to give our entire cast a round of applause. And I do want to call their names right now. Beginning with Miss Taylor Hudson, please come on out to the stage.
Thank you. I salute all you women, Tootie, Irisi, Victor, Tyrone, my nephews, my cousins, my nieces, my nephews, all of you. I salute all you women. You all have a story. Tell it. We'll be a lot better people if we start telling our stories and stop continuing with this tradition of not telling a truth. I salute my cast. Give us a second. We're going to get up out here so y'all can talk to us. Let me get them a hand clap, please.
Give them all another big round of applause, everybody. Thank you so much. You're going to hear from more. You're going to hear more from me.
All right, let's go.
You got a DJ on the ones and twos? Let me run back there. Oh, pick up my book, 7 Ways to Make the Grade, Amazon, all that stuff. I got to let you know, because it has some of this stuff in it. You know, we've been living this stuff. And I want to tell it. They told it. Give them another big round of applause, everybody. You're every door.